Hello viewers, welcome to the program. This is You and Your Taxes. I'm Rohit Vyas and you're watching us coast to coast throughout North America. And our guest again is Neel Shah. He's the Trusts and Estates attorney, has been with us for a while, talking all about trusts and estates and wills and the like. As usual, at the outset, I'd like to ask our viewers to remind themselves and remind you all that this program is produced by TV Asia purely for informational purposes, to help the community in making their own decisions. In no way does the program solicit any kind of, any kind of subject from you or anything like that, giving you no advice, asking for nothing in return. All TV Asia is doing is providing this as an informational piece of guidance for each and every one of you. Should you ever need advice in terms of taxes and planning and estates and trusts and so on and so forth, you are advised to seek your own professional advice from whomever you choose. Once again, Neel, thank you for joining us on TV Asia, on You and Your Taxes.
Great to be back.
Let's talk about a subject I don't think we've touched upon so far in many of the preceding episodes. This is planning for families. And let's talk specifically about planning for families of young children. We're in a new tax year, I'd like to point out. This is 2016. And should people start looking at tax law, should people start looking at things involving their young children, and why should they start looking at things like that at this stage? If children are young, a lot of us are of the perception, of the view that, kids are young still, we don't have to worry about planning for them right now. So first of all, let's start with why should someone even look at planning for children young, and then how young are we talking about in terms of kids and planning for them?
You know, Rohit, I'll tell you, when it comes to this sort of planning, most people won't even start thinking about this kind of planning until they actually have children. And, you know, we spend a lot of our time, especially on this show, and just in general, when we're doing our planning, talking about finances. But there's one aspect of planning which has nothing to do with money, which parents absolutely have to address when it comes to any sort of wills, trusts, or any sort of foundational planning, and that's guardianship. Guardianship, I mean, as the father of an 11-year-old and a 10-year-old right now, I have to, as a responsible parent, address certain concerns, specifically what happens if I'm not around? What happens if my wife is not around? Who's going to step in and actually become the guardians of my children? And when I'm talking about guardians, I'm not talking about somebody who's necessarily managing the money. What I'm really talking about is who's going to be the day-to-day
decision-maker.
Mm-hmm. You know, in previous episodes, we've talked about trustees. Trustees are the people who are going to actually take care of the money. But I always use the high school prom as an example. You know, for those of your viewers who are watching right now in the U.S., we know the high school prom is a big rite of passage. Well, if you're thinking in the context of a high school prom, think of the trustee as the person who cuts the check for the prom ticket, cuts the check for the limousine, cuts the check for the corsage or for the bouquet. But the guardian is the person in that prom example who's going to decide how late they can stay out at the prom. It's the person who's going to decide whether or not they can go to the short house afterwards. So not even the financial aspects, but very important for any parent, for a child who's especially under 18, is who's going to be that decision maker? Who's going to be that guardian?
So Neel, but what age should someone start looking at that sort of thing? I mean, let's say you're a new couple, you don't even have children yet, but now you got a newborn on the way. Should they start thinking about it at that point? I mean, or do you wait till the child is actually born and then decide this is the age that there's this sort of a bar where, okay, this is the age when you should start planning something like this?
Mm-hmm. Very, very important that if you have a child on the way, you have to start addressing this. And for a couple of reasons. First of all, and I hate thinking like this, but when you're checking in as part of this prenatal type checkup, one of the forms is going to ask you whether or not you have a living will, whether or not you have an advanced healthcare directive. And this is specifically for the mother-to-be. So as part of your wills, as part of your planning, you want to make sure you've addressed some basic needs as to who's going to be your healthcare agent. And do you have a living will? And are you an organ donor? Partly because the hospital and the doctor is going to ask you this. Secondly, what I found is that first lead up period until the baby's actually born, the parents are very busy getting everything taken care of. You and I are both parents. We know what happens after that baby's born. Paperwork is not necessarily at the top of your list. It's going to be diapers, and it's going to be formula, and it's going to be all these other pools that you have right now. So always better when you have a child on the way, but if you haven't taken care of it before, then by all means, take care of it now.
So, I mean, now this is, we're thinking about, I mean, when you're talking about guardianship issues, mm-hmm. are we talking about something catastrophic happening to you as adults, you know, and that type of thing. And that's something we should be keeping in mind when planning for our future and our family's futures.
Yeah, certainly. I think what you'll see is most of the time people will say, I have a will, and inside of a will, I have named a guardian. That's the catastrophic planning that we all think of. It's death. But what you also have to realize is wills don't mean anything until the person actually passes away. While you're living, the will means nothing. Yeah. It's a document which is waiting for somebody to actually pass away before it becomes enacted. So what you need is some stopgap measures. You need some stopgap measures that say, if I'm disabled, if I'm incapacitated, who's going to be the person who's going to take care of my child in that context? And the will is irrelevant in that context. So you've got to have a power of attorney, or you've got to have some other document where you've specifically laid out who's going to be my guardian in that case. And of course, particularly for our viewing audience, a lot of our viewers don't have a logical choice. You know, for sometimes you have a sibling or you have a parent who's going to step in, but what if your parents are abroad, or what if your logical guardians are abroad? What do you do in that context?
What is the worst case scenario if you don't plan a guardianship issue, you know, thing? I mean, if you just don't plan for this, what can happen? I mean, in the United States, for instance, let's talk about our community here in the United States. Mm-hmm. Young couples out there, they have kids, they're not planning this at all, right?
Correct.
I'll be honest, I didn't plan this when I was a lot younger. What happens in the worst case scenario should something terrible happen? And we don't wish that, obviously, on anybody. You wish everything goes off well,
right?
But life is uncertain. So what happens then if nothing is determined in advance?
Sure. Well, let's talk worst case scenario. Worst case scenario is you have, well, even better than worst case scenario is you have somebody who's the logical person who steps up. And all the remaining family members, all the remaining well-wishers are all on the same page as to who should be that guardian. Sometimes that doesn't happen. Often that doesn't happen. In bad scenarios, what will happen is you'll have two sets of people who want to be guardians. Maybe it's two sets of parents who want to be guardians. Or even worse than that, there's nobody who's the logical person. If you have people here who are on H-1B visas, or for example, or all their family is back in India, then you don't have somebody who's that logical guardian. Well, worst case scenario, now you've got the surrogates court, which is one court which we talked about before, which handles a lot of the financial aspects. Now you have the family court, who's got to look out for the best interests of the child. So you've got these two competing courts, which are, I shouldn't say competing, but two parallel processes which are going on right now, and they might not always play well with each other. You could have two sets of grandparents. You could have two sets of uncles and aunts or grandparents or two different families who are basically arguing about who should be the appropriate guardian. So if what we've done from a planning context, when we have somebody who's absolutely got nobody here or has long-term wishes to have guardianship go back to India, is we will actually name a temporary guardian, and we'll really lean on our clients to say, okay, find somebody. Even if it's a friend, even if it's a neighbor, even if it's somebody who's in California and you live on the East Coast, or somebody who's in the East Coast and you live on the West Coast, pick somebody who's within the borders right now who can step in and be a temporary guardian until you can have the long-term aspects, overseas guardianship and immigration, all that worked out. So at least you're not faced with a situation where a child is being sent to a foster home. And we all know of all the evils that happen with foster homes potentially. So rather than even deal with all that, you choose who's going to be that temporary guardian, and once the temporary guardianship no longer serves this purpose, then we can have the permanent guardian go back to the...
This is a very, very important subject, Neel. I'm glad we talked about it. We'll take a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk a bit more about some related subjects, you know, related to this planning for families. Our guest is Neel Shah. He's Trust and Estates Attorney, and this is You and Your Taxes. We'll be right back after this short break.